right. All right, everyone. We're going to get started. So our apologies. Obviously, we had a rich keynote, so we're a little behind, but it's okay. There was some cushion. We'll make it up. So it's my great pleasure to introduce our parallel session on threats to academic freedom in the U.S. and Canada. And as I said in the morning, we always like to have a session on the issues in the place where the event is hosted. And obviously, we're stretching the borderline there a bit. And we really have a very strong panel and a lot of issues that could be covered in a very short amount of time. So without any delay, I'm delighted to introduce our moderator, Nathalie de Rosiers, who's the Dean and the Professor of Law at University of Ottawa, Canada, Fellow of the Royal Society of Canada, recognized constitutional law expert, and previously General Counsel to the Canadian Civil Liberties Association. So, Nathalie, thank you.
Bienvenue à Montréal. Welcome to Canada. It's a great session. We're really eager to get going. I will introduce the speakers in such a cursory way that I will allow them a little bit more time to say their piece. So we are so delighted to have a range of views here that I think will continue the discussion that was initiated earlier on by our keynote speaker. So we will start with Professor Firmin DeBrabander of the Maryland Institute of College of Art, and followed by Shaundra Lewis of Texas Southern University. And they are going to talk a little bit about gun law and how to imagine the issues of academic freedom in light of the U.S. relation possession of firearms on higher education campuses. We'll then move to a Canadian counterpart who was the past president of CAUT, well-known in Canada, Penni Stewart, who is at York University, and discuss a little bit the Canadian situation. And we will finish with our last speaker, John Wilson, who has written a book, Patriotic Correctness, Academic Freedom and Its Enemies, and we'll put all of these concerns in a more general pressures scenes from the American Association of University Professor. And so I'm delighted to be here. I have some questions for you after we'll hear from each of them, and we'll certainly, because it is freedom of expression, we'll allow certainly a lot of questions from the audience as well. Yes.
Good morning. I'm Professor Lewis from Thurgood Marshall School of Law in Houston, Texas. And one of the biggest threats that we are facing right now is that the state legislature deems it prudent to allow anyone with a concealed handgun license to carry firearms on public university college campuses, including in classrooms, into our offices. And my position is, this threatens academic freedom, what I call constitutional academic freedom. The First Amendment in the United States provides that no Congress shall not make no law abridging the freedom of speech. And one could think of no symbol that makes me want to be quiet than the symbol of a gun, right? And so even if I can't see it, but I know that the students and faculty are carrying it, how I teach my class may be a little different. I might not discuss controversial, sensitive topics. I might not push the students to criticize them as much as we do using the Socratic method in law school. I teach law school. I just had to give 2 F's for plagiarism. I might not meet with the students in person. I think I'm going to send you an email with what you did and tell you to see the dean. And so, about 10 years ago, almost every university prohibited guns. 29 states had laws that expressly prohibited the carrying of firearms on college campuses. There have been a lot of headline-making school shootings and mass shootings outside of the school context that has prompted this fear of someone being defenseless against a mass shooter. And so this is one of the solutions. If the bad guys are going to have guns, let's just arm everyone, the good guys. I say the good guys because, remember, to be able to carry, you have to have a concealed handgun license. You can only get a concealed handgun license if you're 21 years or older, unless you were in the military. You can serve in the military in the U.S. at 18 years old. You have no criminal record and no documented evidence of mental illness. I say documented because it varies by jurisdiction, and so in some states, you have to be adjudicated by a court or a hospital to have been mentally ill, which does not exclude a lot of people. So needless to say, it's very easy to get a concealed handgun license, and I am a testament to that. I did not grow up with guns. I never touched a gun, but I have a concealed handgun license. I went undercover to show how easy it was. And despite me not going in there with a gun, telling them I don't own a gun, I've never fired a gun, never loaded, and did not know how to load it, the instructor promptly loaded, shoved me in, and said, fire, and I did as told, since everyone around me had guns. And it was easy to pass because the target is just moving like this, right? And then I had a license. Don't worry, I don't have a gun. But so the reality is that a lot of the mass shooters were able to legally obtain their firearms. So this goes back to the constitutional issue of academic freedom, which comes from the right to free speech. And so there's a debate among scholars of who has this constitutional First Amendment academic freedom right. Does it belong to the college or university, the institution? Does it belong to individual professors and students? And it's my position it belongs to both. And so the question is, you have on the one side the First Amendment right to free speech, but then you have the proponents of campus carry, the students say, well, what about my Second Amendment right to carry firearms for protection? And then you have this tension. No U.S. court has addressed this issue yet. And the reason is money. Because state schools have to receive a significant amount of funds from the government. And if you don't follow the law, as the University of Utah discovered when back in 2001, they refused to implement the campus carry originally, and the legislature recommended or introduced legislation that would cut the president's salary in half. Needless to say, they somehow decided to withdraw suit, reached a compromise, and never reached court. I myself, because the legislation takes effect in my state in 2 months, now have to worry over the summer, should I get a bulletproof vest? Should I renew my license? What should I do? Should I galvanize my colleagues and say, let's protest, let's not show up? Maybe we should Skype into class. What should we do? I just got tenure, so I'm a little nervous, you understand. And the president has not signed off just quite yet. So it's like, what do we do? Because the courts have not addressed this issue yet, in my current work in progress, I am looking at or proposing a test for how could the court resolve these two constitutional competing claims. What should they look at? And so then first I look at, has the law historically favored one constitutional right over another? And the answer is yes, and you can imagine it is what? Free speech, right? Because in the early 1900s, the Supreme Court recognized an individual right to free speech, but it wasn't until 2008 that they recognized the right, an individual right to bear arms in District of Columbia v. Heller. And so, also if you note, the framers must have thought the First Amendment right was more important. It is the first in the Bill of Rights, coming before the Second Amendment. And then as a society, we view the right to freedom of speech more favorably than we do the right to carry bear arms, because you're really only carrying the firearm to do what? To kill either an animal, that's lawful, some animals as long as they're not extinct, and then people in self-defense. So it's viewed less favorably. So of course that factor would weigh more in favor of protecting free speech. Also, I look at whether campus carry laws burdens one right more than the other. And so is there an alternative to carrying a firearm that gives individuals the right to feel safe on campus? And so this is how lots of states over the last 5 or 6 years have introduced various legislation trying to deal with these two competing constitutional claims. So for instance, in the state of Florida, they decided that you can bring a stun gun. You can carry a stun gun, it's not lethal, not a firearm. In Arkansas, they just recently passed a law where faculty, staff, and employees can carry, but not students, as most shootings do are caused or by students, with the exception of the University of Alabama, where a professor was denied tenure and shot everyone in the department and killed everyone in the department. So the threat to academic freedom and speech is real. We have real examples of that. How am I doing with time? Oh, well, with that, I think I'm going to pass it off. There's a lot of policy reasons, philosophical reasons, for not having guns on campus. And if you're interested, I wrote an article on it called Bullets and Books by Legislative Fiat, Why Academic Freedom and Public Policy Permit Higher Education to Say No to Guns. And it was published in the 48th volume, the first article in the Idaho Law Review. Thank you for your time and attention.
I think I'm going to be lazy and speak from here if you all can hear me. Yes? Okay. So thank you, Shaundra. I'm going to pick up where Shaundra left off. I approached the issue of what's called the campus carry movement from a philosophical position, because I am a philosopher. I'm a political philosopher, and I wrote a book last year on the gun rights movement in America, which I call the radical gun rights movement, because that seems to be the only kind right now in America. The NRA is utterly radical and uncompromising, and they get their way. And that boggles the mind, and I wanted to understand why. I wanted to understand what this said about America and Americans. In general, I'll say this. The gun rights movement, like the NRA, they like to say that they are the champions of democracy, and that gun rights, the Second Amendment, is the most important right we have in a democracy, and we only have a democracy because of the Second Amendment. That's what they tell us. So in my book, which I wrote last year, aptly called Do Guns Make Us Free? The answer is no. In my book, I argued that the gun rights movement does not advance our democracy, or where it's not an essential to our democracy, and in point of fact, their radical agenda right now is undermining our democracy in many ways, and campus carry is one of these ways. And so I devote a chapter to discussion of guns in academia, and not only that, but the effect of our gun culture on schools as such, and I'm going to speak a little bit to that as well, so towards the end here. I don't know if Shaundra touched on this point, and these numbers sometimes are fluid, but I believe that campus carry is legal in 9 states, and Texas will be the 10th. And I'd just like to point out there's a lot of state legislatures that are considering it. So it could move on. I would also like to point out that there are now 10 states in America that do not require permits for concealed carry. And I'll let that sink in. I approached this as a philosopher, and I was thinking, I live in Baltimore, I live in Maryland, which thankfully does not have campus carry. But there was a famous American philosopher who lived in Baltimore for a while, taught at Hopkins, named John Dewey. And John Dewey was not only a very important philosopher of democracy, but a very important philosopher of education. And he maintained that the classroom is the basic building block in a democracy where the crucial process of socialization takes place. In the classroom, young adults from different backgrounds, and children, of course, from different backgrounds, traditions, perspectives, sometimes very different backgrounds and perspectives. They convene, they learn to talk to one another in the classroom, and collaborate, and they learn to negotiate conflicts, and crucially, they do this peacefully. And these are all very basic talents in a democracy. In the U.S., in the college classroom, and I'm thinking especially the humanities classroom, such as I teach, the college classroom is supposed to, the humanities classroom is supposed to play a further role in nourishing a democracy. We aim to create an environment where young adults feel comfortable to air controversial ideas and contemplate them and debate them in turn, and this is a very interesting point to make after Professor Stone's conversation with us just a minute ago, but that's the goal. And if these endeavors go well, they may lead to raucous debates, ideally, and students will take up these very divisive ideas like race, abortion, and now gun rights. That's one of the most divisive. Offense may be given and offense may be taken. That's the way it's supposed to be. Those are the rules of the game. And I've argued that guns are an appropriate addition to all that. And to put a point on it, guns threaten the major goals of the classroom that have been mentioned. The mere likelihood, I mean, they will be concealed in the classroom, they'll be in backpacks. The mere likelihood of their presence has a chastening effect. Their presence will make these make nervous young adults. I already have a hard enough time with young adults taking them, bringing them out of their shells to expose themselves and to take potentially personal or dangerous lines of argument, and guns are not going to help me do that. They'll make them less likely to speak out on controversial topics. What's more, guns are inherently divisive tools. Shaundra was talking about what a gun says, the symbolism of a gun. Guns do not bind people together. They drive people apart through mutual suspicion or hostility. And they suggest that perhaps differences and conflicts should not be or will not be solved peacefully. Because they do not nourish mutual trust, but mutual suspicion instead, and lead to greater prevalence of violent resolution to conflicts, as we're seeing in the United States, armed classrooms defy Dewey's goal of socialization. Guns in the classroom would gravely undermine threaten the university's mission in the U.S. to develop citizens. That's what I understand our mission to be at these colleges is in the United States. We are training students, young adults with critical thinking skills to be active and questioning citizens in our democracy. So there's a pedagogical mission at the college and a political one, and guns on campus, I argue, will undermine that. As if fulfilling these fears, there was a report this past spring that a faculty group at the University of Houston, the faculty had convened in a setting like this to talk about how to prepare for the law that was going to come into effect in the fall when there would be guns in the classrooms, and one faculty peer group offered a set of recommendations, and some of these recommendations to their peers, their other faculty, was they said, be careful discussing sensitive topics, drop certain topics from your curriculum, don't go there if you sense anger. So this, of course, was troubling because it suggests a form of self-censorship. Faculty at the University of Houston reveal fears that guns in the classroom pose a major threat to free speech. And if there's anywhere in a democracy that we should allow and encourage free speech, it would be the classroom, I would think. Related is the fear that guns in the classroom will have an especially dampening or censoring effect on inherently radical ideas and topics. And one faculty member at Houston that was quoted, she teaches classes on Marxist and queer theory, and she was especially fearful of what it would be like to teach those topics, which are, you know, very controversial, especially in a state like Texas, I would imagine, with the prospect of armed students around you. Am I okay? Oh, 5 minutes? Okay, I'm going to talk about something else now. I'm going to talk a little bit about development in my state, in Maryland. Maryland is known as having some of the strongest gun control laws in the country, which is not saying much, okay? I live in Baltimore City, where there's a murder a day, usually with guns. So that's what it means to live in a state in America that has pretty good gun laws. I was concerned about our gun. I'm concerned about our gun culture and the radical gun rights movement more broadly, and its impact on education. The increased likelihood of school shootings and the traumatic media coverage that ensues when we have them, these are leading to alarming trends in how our schools prepare for such violence. Once upon a time in America, for example, you would have prepared, students would have prepared for the possibility of a nuclear attack. They would have climbed under their desks, which would not have done much, but that was the drill. And when I was in school, we had fire drills, of course. Now my children, in their schools in Maryland, they do training for active shooters. And my middle school son told me what they do. They sit along the wall, they lock the doors, they pull the shades, they turn off the lights, and they practice sitting quietly for 10 minutes at a time, as if there were a shooter roaming the halls. That makes me very upset, very sad. So what have schools decided to do? Well, in my state of Maryland, there is a company that had the great idea of making bulletproof whiteboards. Like that. That's not big enough, though, but bulletproof, and they were sold to a local university, University of Maryland Eastern Shore. And the idea is, of course, that in the case of an active shooter, students or faculty could rip them off the wall and deflect the bullets. The manufacturer in question, Hardwire LLC, also makes bulletproof clipboards for teachers, bulletproof shields, and bulletproof inserts for backpacks. In another line of their business, they installed 52 pieces of armor in a local baseball stadium, magnetically attached to beams and disguised as advertisements for local business. In the case of a shooting, the piece of armor will come right down off the beams to offer protection, and I imagine their marketing ideas to sell this to schools and colleges to put in cafeterias and gyms and the like. It should not be of any surprise to you all that Hardwire LLC is a defense contractor. Formerly in the business of providing armaments for the military in Iraq and Afghanistan, when those wars wound down and contracts dried up, they looked for opportunities elsewhere and found them in our burgeoning gun violence problem. And here's a quote from the CEO. He said, "We used to have a bad fire problem. Now we have a bad gunfire problem. And that gunfire problem is a $33 billion industry. I don't think it's probably going away," unquote. And there was a customer testimonial on the company website that caught my eye. The student said, quote, "The Sandy Hook shooting," which was in Connecticut, where 20 first graders were killed in their classroom, "the Sandy Hook shooting took place in a small town with a very low crime rate, much like our own. Now that we have these Hardwire's bulletproof shields, we have a feeling of security. This peace of mind makes our day-to-day lives less worrisome and ushers in the normality we felt before the incident." Am I okay? All right, I'm going to keep going. One more minute. I could talk for hours about this. So, I'm alarmed that these armaments might be considered normal, of course. I think that's very distressing. We are creating a massive gunfire problem in the United States. It occurred to me in the context of this conference that the United States is willfully turning itself into a war zone. And every other industrial democracy in the world has found ways to limit the number of guns in circulation and cut the numbers of gun deaths dramatically. But in the United States, we deliberately refuse to do so. We have a gun per person in America, and instead of controlling the absurd number of firearms society, and instead of controlling how criminals or the mentally ill get their hands on said guns, because most states do not have universal background checks on private gun purchases. Because of all this, in the United States, we have decided to outfit our schools as if they were armed bunkers. That's better than taking guns away. And my children's school, the principal recently announced with some pride, but also some ambivalence, that they had installed a new entry system to the door. She said it was a Sally port. And then she said, "That's the kind of entry system they install in prisons." And I think I'll probably end there.
Well, as always, Canada's a pallid, a somewhat pallid thing, but I have threats too. And like Professor Stone, I think you'll hear many of the same themes from me today about academic freedom, but I locate the site of contestation very differently. I agree it's fragile, I agree it's contested, I agree it's being bitten off in big chunks academic freedom now, and I'm going to argue what we have is academic freedom but Canadian universities. But I locate the site squarely with our universities and our university administrations, who I believe have failed entirely to step up to promote, protect, and advocate for academic freedom. Just a word about Canada. I know we're from all over here, and in case you don't know, we're a largely public system, although rapidly privatizing because we're becoming more and more dependent on student tuition fees. But largely public. We're provincially, higher education is a provincial responsibility, which means we avoid the excesses of centralization that some countries have, but it also leads to unevenness in standards and resources. But most importantly, I think, is where a difference comes for Canada is we have the highest density of union organization of any sector of our economy. Academics teaching in Canada are about 90% of us are members of unions and teaching as members of unions. And so the importance of that is that academic freedom is incorporated into our collective agreements, which means we, many of us, have good, strong, robust protections. But that brings me to my first threat to academic freedom. Because even though you can put academic freedom into a collective agreement, and then you can grieve it, and you can arbitrate it, and you can do all kinds of things with it, the biggest single threat to academic freedom today remains casualization and precarious labor. And Canada, like certainly the United States, and I think a large part of our world, is absolutely having more and more and more casualized appointments and fewer permanent or tenure track appointments. And so the problem, of course, is that even if you have academic freedom in your collective agreement, if you're casualized, employers can get rid of you only too easily by cutting out programs, cutting out jobs, moving around. So it's, I've certainly seen that at my university. So casualization really remains to us the huge stumbling block to academic freedom. Unfortunately, in Canada, we have had governments who didn't believe in data at all. We now have a government that believes partially in data, but not in collecting data on casualization. We do, however, know from individual university reports that something over 50% of our teaching is done by members of the precariat in the academy, and continues to rise and has been rising over many years. The second threat I wanted to raise really comes from the continuing transformation of our universities and colleges, partly caused by government cuts, which have been devastating to Canadian universities in many ways, but partly also from the way the cuts have caused a reframing of priorities and where they implicitly, and now more and more explicitly, pit institutions against each other. We're now engaged in a real competition, a competition for resources, a competition for stars, everything. We're just in everything's become sort of a competitive notion. And at the same time, accountability, as it has, I know, in the United States, certainly in Canada, has gone wild. And our institutions are far more accountable than most institutions in the private sector. Most recently, universities in Canada have been subject to budget priority exercises. And these have led to drastic cuts and the threat of cuts to what are called less effective programs. More effective programs are parking. Less effective programs are languages, the humanities, gay studies, queer studies, women's studies. And this means the impact on academic freedom is some debates are simply missing. They're starting to go missing in our campuses. It also has a profound effect on how free programs and people feel to speak out because they're worried that their program will be the next to be cut. And of course, part of this is the now banal observation that university administrations have become more like corporate managements. But the important thing there, I think, is that, well, it's a truism now. It means that we now come to be seen, like as with many other industries, as owing a duty of loyalty to our employer and our universities as a brand. So in the Globe and Mail, for example, this week, there was a description of faculty member X being hired somewhere and said the faculty member was described as being with a university, not working at or at a university, a very, very corporate description. And part of this then leads, I think, to a development of policies that threaten expression rights and freedom of assembly at our universities. And part of this is once you have brands, once you have brand loyalty, once you have the notion of York University, which is the university I work at, York University starts to protect itself, and it protects itself from its own students and faculty. So there are things like what we call the temporary use of space policy, booking policies. They seem so innocuous at one level, but what they do is they control who has access to what space. And all of a sudden you find that only recognized groups, only certain groups have access to booking rooms. There's no more spontaneous organization or spontaneous assembly. It's all, you can book it, maybe, but it really, so we have a less and less free access for students and faculty to space. More and more the space is considered as private. If you fall afoul, you can find yourself, if you're a student group and you fall afoul of the administration, you can find yourself with no trespassing orders. So again, I think there's a real loss in spontaneousness and freedom of assembly. Policies that say you can't poster, you can't flyer, you can't advertise, you can't put things up also are tremendously discouraging and chilling on freedom of expression. There's a noticeably larger presence of police. So emblematic of this is, and just to bring home my point about how universities have failed to protect and promote academic freedom and freedom of expression, emblematic of this transformation was a 2011 policy by an organization now called Universities Canada. This is an organization whose membership is made up of all university presidents across Canada. The president signed on to a statement that said, okay, academic freedom. It's called the Academic Statement on Academic Freedom, and it said, freedom to teach, okay, and determine curriculum. Freedom to do your research and disseminate the results, okay. But they happened to conveniently drop the freedom to criticize your own institution and its policies, which is an intrinsic part of academic freedom, for a very long time, and also they conveniently dropped the freedom to criticize outside your institution without being subject to reprisal by your employer. So extramural speech rights and some intramural speech rights just dropped off the radar, and all of our university presidents, with the one notable exception from the University of Toronto president, signed on to this policy. And that has signaled to faculty and students the real intent to narrow academic freedom. And do I still have a few minutes? Okay, I want to turn to a third threat, which is, and I think Professor Stone referred to this, which is the growth, the proliferation in Canada over the last, really about a decade, of what we call respectful workplace policies. I think often in the United States they're called civility policies and things like that. These policies in Canada have tended to be integrated into our harassment policies, and they've vastly broadened the regulatory reach of policy over all speech. Respectful workplace policies seek to regulate and constrain speech so that you have a notion of academic freedom. And I kind of cringe when Professor Stone used the word responsible today, because that's exactly what's coming up for us. Academic freedom is fine, it's good. We should all have it, but it should be responsible, it should be respectful, it should be safe. We should practice safe academic freedom. So under these policies, rudeness, incivility, aggressive speech, debate become as easily dealt with as harassment, as severe abuse or bullying. So there's just no difference. If you're rude, you can be charged with harassment, just as if you've been abusive to somebody. And the problem well, there are many problems with it, but one of them is it's a very easy tool to use harassment to get rid of unpopular ideas. It's a very easy tool to take ideas that aren't welcome in an institution and use them. You charge somebody with harassment, there's an investigation, things wend their way for a year or two. At Brock University in Ontario, five faculty and some students protested against a program that the university was partnering with a Catholic church. They didn't like the idea of the partnership, and they protested in the normal way and suddenly found themselves all charged with workplace harassment. They were told they could not speak to anybody about this issue while an investigation went on, and the investigation just dawdled on for a year or more. Canadian Association of University Teachers was invited to do an academic freedom investigation, and we did that and carried it out over some time after that. But the fact is, these people, these faculty members, were quite frankly just terrorized, shut down, and left with, you know, no way to voice their own protest over time. And the impact has been very chilling, because what you see now are people self-censoring, right? And that's the problem with when you have academic freedom, but is you start to just not say very much. And more and more, I think we're very quiet about academic freedom on Canadian campuses, and you rarely will hear that word. We had an unprecedented, in my experience, small talk on it in our Senate, and that was because we'd had an incident at my own university, and I will stop right after this. I had said academic freedom is also one of the buts is safety, and we've talked today before, speakers have talked about the need for safe space, but safety is also a trope that is used to curtail freedom of expression in all kinds of ways. And I'll give you one very quick example. At my university, York University, a mural was hung in a student-owned student center that depicted a young Palestinian man watching a bulldozer with a rock in his hand behind his back. That mural upset a lot of people. One donor said he was taking all his money out of York University and he would urge everybody else to take their money too. And there were many, many, many public calls. It was a big thing in the media about taking that mural down. Well, the university did the right thing. The president said, we support freedom of expression. But then the president also said, but we asked our lawyers and we can't take it down. And then he said, and I'm going to be reviewing all the student rules of student conduct to see what we can do, because some of our students don't feel safe, and this has made some students feel unsafe on our campus. And so he noted that the university, while we are committed to freedom of expression, there are other core values, including diversity, inclusivity, and respect. And the saddest thing to me is that, just like academic excellence used to be pitted against equity, we now see academic freedom pitted against inclusivity, diversity, and respect, and with the idea that the academic freedom will be the sorry loser. And I'll end there. Thank you.
Well, I think that's a perfect segue in talking about safety for what I want to discuss about academic freedom and what I think is this threat that the obsession with security poses. But I do want to start off just by mentioning why we do need safety on campus. And I was at the, earlier this week, the Grand Bibliothèque's wonderful exhibit, The Library at Night, which included a virtual reality version of the burning of the Alexandria Library, as well as the burning of the Sarajevo Library. And it was a visual reminder of that intellectual freedom requires security, and we need to protect people from acts of violence and threats of violence. And of course, I'm also reminded of that being here in Montreal, the tragic site of more campus mass shootings, I think, than any other city. The killing of 14 women at the École Polytechnique in 1989, the Concordia University killings in 1992, the 2005 Dawson College shootings. And that was also remind me, in this whole debate over campus carry, that there was an incident recently at Utah State University where a feminist speaker, Anita Sarkeesian, was going to give a speech, and there were a number of lunatics out there who objected to her criticism of some people on the internet, one of whom issued a threat to Utah State, saying that he was going to carry out a Montreal massacre-style attack and explained all the weapons he had. And the reaction of the university to this was that because of Utah's concealed carry laws, they could not stop someone who had a permit from coming into this event where this woman had been threatened to be killed and bringing a weapon in. Like, anyone who had a permit could just bring in their gun, even though there had been this explicit threat to commit a mass killing at this event. And that to me is how ridiculous in some ways in the extremes the campus carry movement is. And the AUP, the American Association of University Professors, along with the American Federation of Teachers, the Association of American Colleges and Universities, and the Association of Governing Boards of Colleges and Universities has condemned these laws, arguing that, quote, a rigorous academic exchange of ideas may be chilled by the presence of weapons. Personally, I'm not so convinced that campus carry is a major threat to academic freedom. I certainly don't think that the Supreme Court, in the wake of a case like Fair v. Rumsfeld several years ago, would ever rule it as such. So I don't think that there's going to be much universities can do in the courts or in the legislatures to stop a lot of this. What worries me in a lot of ways is what universities choose to do to themselves in terms of issues of security. And when it comes to freedom, security is a double-edged sword. We need security to have freedom, but all too often this concept is used to justify repression. We saw that in the United States after 9/11. We see it today in Turkey and many other places where the state demands repression of, and jails academics on the grounds that they are protecting the security of the nation. And I'm currently writing a book about Donald Trump, so I like to quote him whenever I can. And here is how Trump began a chapter in one of his books, quote, "Your civil liberties mean nothing if you're dead," unquote. And this is a very dangerous idea, particularly because, unlike what most of Trump says, it is actually technically true. That you don't have, your civil liberties do mean nothing if you're dead. The problem is that all too often, that becomes truncated to, your civil liberties mean nothing. That the security justification trumps everything else. It trumps freedom rather than serving freedom. And that, I argue, is a real problem, especially on college campuses where there's a growing movement of risk management and threat assessment as sort of the ideology of administrators. And these are the structures that operate within universities. And I'll give you a few examples. There are so many I can't discuss them all, but a few examples of how the obsession with security and safety in campus can be abused. In 2014, Frances Schmidt, a professor at Bergen Community College in New Jersey, shared a photo on Google Plus of his daughter wearing a Game of Thrones t-shirt that read, quote, "I will take what is mine with fire and blood." And a dean who was in his Google Plus network saw the photo and considered this a threat. And so the university administration told him that the word fire could be a metaphor for AK-47s. Which even by Game of Thrones standards is ridiculous. So he was placed on administrative leave without pay for 8 days and told he would have to pass a psychiatric evaluation before he could return. And the college declared, quote, "In following its safety and security procedures, the college investigates all situations where a member of its community expresses a safety or security concern." There's another, of course, famous case. In 2013, a few hours after a mass shooting at Washington, D.C.'s Navy Yard, University of Kansas professor David Guth posted a tweet to his personal Twitter account condemning the National Rifle Association and declaring, quote, "Next time, let it be your sons and daughters. Shame on you. May God damn you," unquote. And Republican legislators immediately demanded Guth's dismissal. The Kansas State Rifle Association president accused Guth of inciting violence against the NRA. and he was quickly suspended and put on administrative leave a few days later, quote, in order to prevent disruptions to the learning environment. And there are many more cases. I'm going to go through just a few more. Hayden Barnes, who was a student at Valdosta State University in 2007, opposed a parking garage on campus for environmental reasons, a parking garage that had been pushed by the president of the university. And so he created a collage in opposition to this and named it, after the president of the university, the Zakari Memorial Parking Garage. And in response, he was accused of having created a threatening document, and he was expelled from the university as a clear and present danger because he used the word memorial. And so that was a death threat against the president of the university. Similarly, in 2011, James Miller, a professor at University of Wisconsin at Stout, posted on his office door an image from the sci-fi series Firefly and a line from the show, "You don't know me, son, so let me explain this to you once. If I ever kill you, you'll be awake, you'll be facing me, and you'll be armed." And the chief of police on campus removed the poster because it refers to killing and could be interpreted as a threat. And so Miller then put up another poster on his office door that said, "Warning, fascism. Fascism can cause blunt head trauma and or violent death. Keep fascism away from children and pets." This was also banned by the police chief because it, quotes, mentions violence and death, and, quote, could be constituted as a threat. And this was done by the campus threat assessment team that determined that this warning against fascism was a potential danger and a potential threat. I won't go through all of these examples. There are several more, but I do want to talk about a couple of recent ones that I think are related to security, although they're not really interpreted that way. One was the firing earlier this year of Melissa Click by the University of Missouri, who had, in a misguided effort to create a safe space around a Black Lives Matter protest, had jostled a student's camera and had called for some muscle to help her in creating this protective barrier. And this was widely claimed to be an act of violence, that she was inciting violence, that she was committing assault by jostling a camera, and she was dismissed without due process by the Board of Curators at the University of Missouri. And in my mind, this is an example of how the safety and security rhetoric is used to dismiss people who have political views that are disagreeable to the people in charge. In this case, it was the Republican legislatures in Missouri who were demanding her firing, and the Board of Curators who wanted to get rid of her. Now, there are a number of conservatives and in the media, and sadly, in some ways, Jeff Stone, who I have a lot of respect for in his speech this morning, who are depicting this obsession with safe spaces and trigger warnings and microaggressions as this grand threat to liberty on campus. And I regard these things as being stupid but insignificant. That is, in the sense that nobody is getting fired for violating safe spaces or failing to give trigger warnings or committing microaggressions. That the real danger comes not from students and their alleged demands for censorship, which are no different than they've been in the past, but from administrative structures. And in many ways, the real problem with safe spaces and trigger warnings and some of the discussion about microaggressions is that it is being used in this narrative of safety and security to justify repression. And so I think that's the real danger. And one example of this I want to talk about, that this danger, that this idea that you need to protect students from hearing controversial ideas, that students need to be emotionally secure and not just physically secure, it is, I think, a growing danger. It has a lot to do with this safety and security mentality. And one example of this and why it's not the fault of students is the case of the firing of Stephen Salida by the University of Illinois in 2014. And it's notable that the decision by the chancellor to get rid of Stephen Salida came before even a single student had complained about his offensive tweets about Israel. There were many alumni, rich donors, politically influential people who complained, but not one student had gotten around to emailing the chancellor before she decided to get rid of him. This is not about listening to students. Universities don't care what students think. They care about people with money and power. And so the censorship is not coming from students, it is coming from administrative structures. And in justifying his dismissal, the Board of Trustees at the University of Illinois declared, quote, "Disrespectful and demeaning speech that promotes malice is not an acceptable form of civil argument if we wish to ensure that students, faculty, and staff are comfortable." It also argued, "Our campuses must be safe harbors where students and faculty from all backgrounds and cultures feel valued, respected, and comfortable expressing their views." And that's lovely and all that, but it's also true that sometimes students and faculty need to be challenged, questioned, and made uncomfortable. That a university where everyone is always comfortable is a university that suppresses dissent and questioning. Universities are not safe harbors and safe spaces, they are free harbors and free spaces. And if we say that safety and security is the fundamental value of a university, we will inevitably jeopardize liberty on campus. No one ever started a university for the purpose of employing security guards. That's not the purpose. The purpose of a university is to promote a free and open expression of ideas. We must always put security in the service of freedom and never make freedom subordinate to that security. And we only limit freedom to protect someone else's fundamental freedom and never for the sake of security or their comfort. And that's when, that's what we must really fear, I think, in this debate, is that the ideology of safety and security, the idea that keeping people comfortable and safe trumps everything else, that to me is the great threat that we're currently seeing on college campuses. Thank you.
Well, thank you. What a great diversity. I have a couple questions maybe to get us started, and then by all means, if you have questions, please raise your hand, and we have a microphone that will be located. First, I think to talk a little bit about the guns on campus, I just wanted to ask you, how come you cannot challenge, how come the students are not engage in resisting this? Or the students split, or can there not be a movement, a student-driven movement? Here in Quebec, we have a petit carré rouge when students resist. Can you not have a white carré or something to resist this? How come the students are not involved there?
Okay, well, actually, the people who are advocating for the guns are the students. There's okay. Organization, not all the students are everywhere, because I've gone to Idaho to speak, in my mm-hmm. university, which is very diverse, one of the most in the nation, and the majority of these people do not want guns, but the voices of the students for concealed carry are louder because they have the NRA behind mm-hmm. them. And so I don't know why some students have offered to protest next year, but you're right, there's an armed campus movement too, but I've not seen them be as, voice first as the other people on the other side.
Yeah, I mean, it mirrors the dynamic in the United States as a whole. The vast majority of even gun owners favor gun safety measures, but the NRA wins out with their radical and compromising agenda because they win out. Their success breeds more success, and that minority is able to overshadow all the other voices in the debate, and that's one of the driving questions I have. Why is that the case? Why are they able to win that out? Why are they able to win out? Why don't Americans who generally support gun safety measures, why aren't they sufficiently alarmed by the state of affairs in America? This is like the new normal. They've accepted this, they tolerated this. One thing I would add, in case it wasn't made clear by either of our talks, the vast majority of university systems, actually all of them, are against it. So in all the states where they have legalized campus carry, the university leadership said no. Mm-hmm. They didn't want it, and they were overruled. And the vast majority of students, when asked, they are against it, but Shaundra's right, the vocal minority wins out.
So the idea of institutional autonomy, you know, a part of academic freedom is also some protection for the university as having institutional autonomy, is overruled in that context completely.
Yeah, in 9 states, because most states leave it up to the individual mm-hmm. universities and colleges to decide for themselves, and of mm-hmm. course they say no guns. Mm-hmm. But in 9 states, they have been bold enough to say, university, you cannot ban guns.
Public universities.
Public universities.
Public universities.
Private universities can opt out. Mm-hmm. Public universities cannot.
And the reason that the public universities are buckling under is because of Republican legislatures that are seeing this through. Okay. Every single case.
Arkansas, Idaho, Texas,
Florida.
North Carolina.
So would there be something on an international scene that could be done to explain, for example, that it, why would I send our students from different areas of the world to a university where guns are tolerated? Is there some additional pressures that could be done? I mean, this is the place to talk about this, you know. What are the additional pressures that you think could be brought about to be helpful to you?
Well, I would say, I mean, there has been some rumblings. I mean, in many of these states, so North Carolina is one, I believe.
No, well, it's Arkansas, Colorado, Idaho, Kansas, Mississippi, Oregon, Tennessee, Texas, and Wisconsin.
But that was in 2011?
Yeah, this is since 2011.
I think North Carolina has joined.
Just now.
And Florida's legislature. And many of these states, like Texas, these are very esteemed universities where students come from all over the world, and there has been some discussion about whether international students will feel comfortable coming. There was one prominent incident happened at the University of Texas Austin this past year where the dean of the School of Architecture, I believe, he accepted a job at the University of Pennsylvania, I think, and he said part of the reason was he just didn't want to deal with guns in the classroom. So will there be flight from these universities? I don't know.
Okay.
Maybe.
And there was also a news story about a student declining acceptance to University of Texas because of the campus carry.
Yeah, and
I wanted to move to you. Just
to follow up on that, there is no international pressure that will work because consider in Kansas, when Kansas legislators, they went after David Guth just for criticizing the NRA and then created a policy banning the use of offensive social media by misuse of social media by professors. The Kansas Board of Regents did. The legislators in Kansas are not going to care mm-hmm. if there's a threat for foreigners not to come. Remember, a majority of Republican voters want to have Muslims banned from the United States, from entering the United States. So if you tell them this law is going to keep foreign students out of your universities, they'll say, great, more Americans. Mm-hmm. We don't want no foreigners. I mean, so there is no way politically, I think, in the structure to yield, to have international pressure have any effect on that. Internal pressure there may be within the political system.
Now, just to bring it back to this, the idealization or the ideology of safety as being a real threat to academic freedom, which I think we all see. I think when I was at the CCLA, the Canadian Civil Liberties Association, we always tried to see what are the triggers, to go after the triggers after also the manifestation. And one of it is also insurance. And neither of you have talked about insurance, but we saw that many of these restrictions on you know, where to protest, how to protest, impose sometimes on student groups additional fees to for them to pay for the additional security that is required if they are inviting or engaging into more controversial speech. Is that as well part of the American story?
Yes, and it's actually a big concern. The organization Foundation for Individual Rights and Education has done a lot on this. It's the heckler's veto idea. It's the idea that if you have a controversial speaker, the university will, really in an attempt to stop controversial speakers, will require you to have more security to deal with people who threaten the speaker and then charge you for the security. So in essence, you have to pay the price because someone threatens you. And of course, they would never apply that if, say, the university president received a death threat. They wouldn't charge the university president and make him pay out of his pocket to defend him. But they do it for student groups and speakers like this regularly, and I think it's something that definitely needs to be changed. There needs to be a fundamental policy on all the college campuses that if someone is threatened, they don't get punished for being threatened. The university provides whatever necessary security to uphold freedom of expression on campuses.
That was one of our demands, actually. Do you have any comments on
that? Yeah, no, I think that's absolutely right. The liability chill one, we've heard it over and over and over again, but there's very clear answers to that, and that has to do with saying our priority is protecting freedom of expression and ensuring that. And, I think that, you know, part of it, though, is that as colleagues, we are also, I won't speak about the court of gun culture, but certainly around civility and safety and security, we are remarkably quiescent.
Yes.
And maybe some of you are thinking the same thing, but I can tell you, I have talks all the time about civility codes and respectful workplace, and people say, it's a good thing. What's wrong with that? I'm always being bullied in my department. I'm being blah, blah, blah. It's a good thing, and it's really hard work to actually get people to grasp that sort of the losses that we occur, or the potential losses, I will say, that we occur when we embrace kind of the regulation of civility. And I think that's where Professor Stone was absolutely right. It's not normative. We should all be civil. Of course we should be. But it's when we seek to regulate and then punish, I think, that we fall off the corner on expressive rights.
And so I think there are many people on the left who have this sort of idea that, well, we can tame the censorship monster. We can put a leash around them and use them as our guard dog for our purposes. And the reality is that the censorship monster is always going to bite you in the ass. Mm-hmm. It's always going to come back to haunt you. And it doesn't work for you. And this apparatus of restriction is never going to serve the interests of liberation or anything like that. It's going to serve the interest of those in power.
So I have three questions from the audience that I've seen, un, deux, and trois. And just before we move there, one of the questions that I had for you to reflect is, as we want to have international scholars at risk that come, are there privacy issues, rules that must be adopted more? I mean, and one of the case that I have in mind is the way in which the university not protecting the privacy of some of its students or of its scholars expose them to threats outside of the university. And that has been something that as we grow international, we may want to consider what are the necessary protection of privacy to protect actually academic freedom throughout the world. Let's go to the questions of the audience. In blue. Come on, go ahead.
All right, thank you very much. Alvin Chung, NYU. I actually wanted to come back to this issue of international implications, but from a different angle, which is how these standards or community norms, even to do with microaggressions, which in North America perhaps might be stupid but insignificant, but certainly aren't for the rest of the world. And I wanted the panel to speak to how these developments might lead to an international leveling down, both in terms of institutions and administrations overseas adopting policies on the basis that everybody else is doing it, which is what happened in Hong Kong a number of years ago. And also with respect to international students who go overseas, absorb these ideas about what is and isn't acceptable in universities and export them. Or in the case of many mainland students, even use these policies as instruments of state policy against speech on campuses that they don't like.
Why don't we take the three questions, and then I'll ask the panel to respond to all three. You have time, that gives you time to think about how to answer really. Yes, madam, in the blue.
Yeah, hello, thank you for the insight. My name is Eleni Andrianopoulou, University of Bielefeld, Germany. So my question is, you talked about a lot about public, semi-public speech, so to say, on campus, on classroom, and so on and so on. But when we're talking about the employer and the loyalty to the employer, this has not only to do with public opinion or public speech. It has also to do with, more private or more personal criticism that you probably have in your workplace. So where do you draw the line? Is it a line? If we say, is a university completely, or should it be a completely different employer than, let's say, a corporate one? And this could imply that this standard would be for every employee in the university, not only the ones that are in research and in teaching. I'm asking also as an administrator.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, thank you. And last question, and then we'll go to the panel to answer the internationalization question and privatization or the question.
Actually, that's a terrific question. Mm-hmm. I'm Kate Stimson, also from NYU. I was wondering, and thank you very much, I was wondering if we were congealing too quickly two different threats to the cult of safety and security. One we might call the conservative threat, which is, I don't feel secure unless I have my gun. And the other is, I don't feel secure unless you stop saying things that make me uncomfortable. But I really think it's important to make a distinction between those two uses or misuses of safety. I want to be respectable, safe, and secure. One is
the word. So shall we, do you want to engage first on the very important question about the international repercussions of having these standards that can get go around the world and become internationalized.
Yes. Well, I do think on that question that it is important for the U.S. to have better standards, whether it's for its own good or as a model for other universities, because the American higher education system is often looked to by other countries as, or at least by some other countries as a model. I'm not sure whether it should be. I'm not entirely sure whether there's more academic freedom in the United States than in other countries, but there often is. I think the AAUP in particular is responsible for having spent a century fighting for academic freedom, developing policies and standards that may be useful for other universities to do. And I think we need to do a better job of improving the kind of speech codes that universities have and the regulations they have so that they can really be good models for these other universities.
So if I can say one word on that one, I mean, I think that part of it is we have to have serious conversations around microaggression, what lies behind it. I mean, I think that for many groups on our campuses, certainly in Canada, there's not equal access to freedom of expression or other freedoms. I mean, we have to, I think, engage very seriously with the issues which underlie them, while at the same time, I hope, promoting freedom of expression and trying to move away from regulatory frameworks. But I do think it's really important. You know, it's not by accident that issues have risen up in very privileged places in the United States, very privileged institutions, where some students are feeling very disappointed. You know, we've seen this reflected over and over again in the media about their experiences. And certainly, I'm at a very, very diverse university, and our students don't feel that there's a lot of, they feel that there's a lot of racism. They feel that there are a lot of issues, and these go beyond micro into macro aggressions. But both, I think we have to be able to engage with the content without necessarily taking on all the regulatory framework, which I think we always have to try to push back on and find other ways. But I mean, for example, in Canada, only 12% of faculty are racialized. 12%. You know, in a city like the city I live in, where more than 50% of the population is racialized, that's kind of scandalous. We just haven't moved ahead. We haven't done what we ought to be doing. Aboriginal people, about 1% of Indigenous people, 2% maybe, are in our universities. You know, there's a lot to be aggressive about. So, I mean, I just want to add that into the mix, I think.
This isn't my research area. I can talk from experience. When I used to work at the University of Houston, there were not a lot of minority faculty, and I remember a minority student coming to me once, actually two, because they were offended by the professor using the N-word. And it wasn't in the case. I said, well, was it in the case? Maybe they're trying to provoke reaction, but they were so disturbed, so they felt comfortable, I guess, because I'm a minority. Professor to come to me, what should they do? And I said, well, maybe they were trying to, you should speak up and say, you know, that's probably what they're trying to do, provoke conversation. It has been used as part of, you know. So I believe in encouraging all views, whether I agree with them or not. And so what I do in my syllabus is I actually put that in there. I have professionalism points, and so I don't like when people sigh or show any sign of disrespect because they disagree with someone or get angry, and I find that that helps to keep the environment, make it conducive to people sharing ideas that may not be popular. But I want to speak about the last question. Even though these are two different issues, I do see an intersection because I believe that if we have more guns on campus, that's going to lead to more censorship because part of the fear of the mass shootings are predominantly committed by people who are mentally ill, right? So now you have to be really careful what you say if you're a faculty member or a student because they're going to think that mm-hmm. you may have some mental illness and overreact mm-hmm. To someone who's just simply eccentric, and maybe that can lead to more censorship.
You're absolutely right about the intersection, but they're very different political they're very different.
Yeah, and the one point I would correct with that is you sort of give the impression, well, the conservatives are the ones who want to force the guns on campus and the liberals are the ones who want to stop making people uncomfortable. And the truth is, you know, stop making me uncomfortable is a conservative idea originally. Some left-wing people have adopted it as a tool of censorship, but it historically, in terms of universities, stop making me uncomfortable, stop talking about sexuality, stop saying political things. Those are conservative views, and they continue. Despite all the attention to political correctness, one of the points I try and make in my book is that you have this other side of conservative correctness, of patriotic correctness, and that the problem here is not that the left or the right are the censors. The problem is that you have regimes of censorship and structures of censorship that we need to get rid of. And in terms of where employees are and who... and what rights they have, I don't believe universities should be fundamentally different from other kinds of institutions. That is that corporations and universities should not be fundamentally different, but I think corporations should be more like universities, mm-hmm. not universities should be more like corporations. And so what I aspire to is a fundamental value of freedom where employees get to say what they think, get to criticize the boss, get to express their political views and don't get fired for it. I think that's especially important at a university, and universities should establish that standard for all employees, academic, professors, as well as staff, as well as students. And that should be a fundamental value, not a property right of tenured professors, but a fundamental value of the university. And then we should try and expand that value to grow it beyond the university. So that's sort of my, that there isn't a sharp line, but that the university approach is the right approach.
You wanted to speak.
Yes. I just wanted to speak to your comment earlier about this intersection of the two, the right and the left, that is, you know, coming in this panel here. I think it's fascinating. You know, I would say that the guns in America and the campus carry, but also the security measures like the bulletproof whiteboards, you know, when those are in every classroom, this contributes to that. That's part of that culture of security that I think John is talking about, and it amplifies it. And you know, when you have those measures, you know, they're inserted as we have more and more shootings. This all leads to make for an environment of alarm, and it's easy to overreact to threats in that state of affairs. You know, so this whole thing is certainly not helping. And the other thing I was thinking, listening to John, is I'm thinking these threats are only taken seriously, not even very seriously, but they're only, I don't know, fobbed off on people because of our proliferating guns in America, and therefore I would argue we need significant gun safety measures imposed and reduce the number of guns out there so we can feel less threatened, and then we can speak freely and fearlessly.
Nathalie, you had raised privacy, and I wanted to say one word on that, and that is certainly in Canada, one of the issues that we're pretty silent on, but emerging issue is surveillance, of course, that's coming as employers shift from email systems to Microsoft and Google, for example. We should have all kinds of concerns about data sharing, where personal data goes, who owns the intellectual data that's transferred, and certainly the Canadian Civil Liberties Monitoring Group and others have raised real privacy concerns, but we kind of gaily move, nevertheless, onto these systems, and again, getting people kind of worried about it is an uphill battle right now, but I think sort of widespread surveillance is coming in a number of ways, and certainly in Canada with anti-terrorist legislation that's still on the books in Bill C-51, we have lots to worry about around privacy under those scores. I'm obviously the worrier here.
Yeah,
I have only worries.
That's it. Yeah. And that's how you keep vigilant. If you don't, you know, that's how you keep your freedom alive. Is any other questions? Yes, there's two questions. Do you have the microphone to handle? In the meantime, I want to take John's point about making the world more like universities and protecting a little bit more. But I think my point was simply to say it is an easier fight to protect freedom if it is not a restricted right. You know. So I think to the extent that the right of employees throughout the world are secure, it's easier to make the case for the good protections of the university. People are more respective of it, and it creates good reflexes as opposed to bad reflexes among employers.
Thank you. Okay. Very, very quickly, I grew up in Lebanon, in the Middle East, during the Civil War, and I'm glad to say I never seen any arm in the school or the university. I have a question, very serious one. I'm wondering if the academic freedom concept apply to the administration of the institution.
Mm-hmm. I believe it does, but,
you answer, and then we'll have time for your question.
Oh, yes, because administrators, too, if they know that I'm also packing or have guns, they may not feel comfortable confronted me, and I know we've been in some very contentious faculty meetings where people do lose their temper sometimes, especially when we're talking about tenure votes and people's jobs are on the line. Those things get pretty heated, and I don't see how knowing there's a gun in the mix can add anything to that. Not to mention accidental discharges. And in Idaho, right after the law passed, a science professor was standing before the class and his concealed weapon fell out and shot him in the foot in his classroom. So there's a lot of policy reasons for not, you know, not just someone might be angry or lose their temper, but it's just not safe to be carrying them around.
Only in the foot.
Only in the foot. Literally shot
them. Yes, your question.
Hello, my name is Karen and I'm from Norway, and thank you for your speeches, and it's, I must say, very interesting and also a bit hard to understand the mindset. You know, to me this is just crazy, honestly. And I remember years ago I went to live in Georgia for a year, and you know, sometimes I got really annoyed about all that talk. I thought they were talking to me about freedom. And I had never met so many scared, unfree people in my life because of that security issue. You know, when security trumps freedom, you know, it's really scary. And it's the paranoia really grows. But the thing is, sometimes I wonder, how do we go about this? How do we teach? What do we teach? Because that whole concept of what freedom is, or how we go about dealing with each other, there must be, I believe that change is possible, so there must be something we can do. Mm-hmm. And or otherwise, you know, scholars at risk community will be dealing with a lot of cases from America, so we have to, you know, and maybe we should, yes. But I think we should talk more about what can we do to change things, because we as intellectuals or as university people, we do have an obligation, I think, to say this is really off the bend.
Is there that's a good way to maybe end the panel? You know, do you have 3-4 minutes to say what's the to-do list, and responding a little bit to the question of both at the institutional level and at what could be, what should we do? What's the next, the agenda for scholars at risk on this issue? Let's start with you, John.
Well, I think some of this is what Jeff Stone talked about, is that once you take repression off the table, then you really have to pay attention to education. Because repression becomes a shortcut. You think we can get what we want, we can stop people from bullying people by having an anti-bullying rule, we can stop people from harassing people by having an anti-harassing rule. We can do these things by just creating a new rule. And the idea is that once you take the rules off the table and say, we have to educate people, we have to deal with these hard cases, and we have to work at this, we have to make this a constant topic of conversation, that we can't even just say we're going to have academic freedom and assume that's going to work. This has to be ongoing work of trying to do this, and also of challenging these boundaries, because frankly, coming from an American boundary, I know this is all crazy, but at some level, if you're around it enough, it seems sensible that people just carry guns around everywhere and shoot each other. And it's refreshing to come somewhere and realize, no, that really is as crazy as I thought that was. And so I think having these different, and having different resources of people coming from areas where there's been repression to come to universities and educate them, to come from areas where there is not people massively slaughtering each other on the streets and come to America and teach people about that, that's very valuable, as well as taking people from America and going to these countries where you just ban political protests and having these people there saying, no, that's wrong, that also is important. So having this international conversation, I think, is a very valuable part of challenging what becomes part of the norms of a society and forcing people outside of their protective boundaries.
Yes, I think that's absolutely right. It's a political project, a political question, and we have to engage with it at that level. We have to have these conversations over and over again. We have to ensure that we're going beyond our boundaries. We have to, at an individual institutional level, ensure that we get the conversation up. I mean, you know, it's interesting to think about, look at the media coverage in the past 6 months, 7 months, 8 months on so many of the issues around student debates across the United States. People are paying attention, people are looking at it, people are thinking about it, we're all talking about it. So that's a very good thing. I mean, it seems to me that's what we need to do lots and lots of, is that sort of trying to take issues out and shake them off and continually trying to engage with them politically at that level.
And about the university administrators, academic freedom, which was the
nope. No, I think individuals may, but I think that we would ordinarily say that administrations do not, that academic freedom is in the collegium, and that's where it sits. So individual administrators who fall afoul can engage with protections quickly enough, but I think that I would not agree with that.
And you're talking about constitutional academic freedom or professional academic freedom? Like, to me, professional academic freedom is the administrator tell me what I can teach and not teach, which I think they can.
See, I have it in a collective agreement, so that's where it sits.
And then constitutional academic freedom arises from the First Amendment, which I think is different.
Just wondering if there is any concept we can call administrative freedom?
No, we've rejected that. It's the Canadian Association of University Teachers.
There is a concept called institutional academic freedom, which is mostly in the legal realm of academic freedom, which I think is complete bullshit and should be opposed, because it's the idea there should be institutional autonomy in the sense of the government not telling universities what to do, like concealed carry laws,
But that's not institutional academic freedom. And universities use institutional academic freedom to say, well, we have academic freedom, so we get to fire you for saying something you don't like, and that's our freedom.
That's
the dangerous part of institutional academic freedom.
But there is a protection of, you know, the government not telling you what to do is actually something that we should reflect more. I mean, we take it for granted here, but that's not the same everywhere.
But that's and a I think that, sword.
So that it's a double-edged sword, but you have to nuance it to a certain extent, because otherwise the imposition of curriculum by government on university is around the corner, I would say. Okay. Any final thoughts?
Well, on the issue of the guns on campus, asking what can be done, maybe a statement from SAR, or maybe if foreign students or faculty feel like boycotting any universities in America, I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Otherwise, I would say that, you know, the international community, the hands are tied. This is, as far as the guns go in America, this is an internal problem internal to U.S. democracy, and is due to a flaw in our system. Where we are captive to a very powerful lobby. Even the democratic voice of the people is not being heard. Of course, the democratic voice of people needs to speak up and be heard and make itself heard, you know. And I think that that's part of a broader problem.
Well, I think on that note, I think we have really, I want to thank your speakers. Great session.
I just want to thank all our panelists once again, and just to let everyone know about a quick scheduling change. We'll actually be adjourning for lunch now for about 50 minutes, and then we'll be having the Syria plenary starting at 1:15 in the moot courtroom. So lunch is available in the atrium now. Please enjoy. It's where the activity expo is. Yeah.